There are over 1,500 species in the bee genus Megachile, and they are found in all corners of the world. But the subgenus of the same name is limited to 32 species across the Northern Hemisphere and 5 species in North America. Females nest in hollow twigs and other suitable crevices and make their nest cells out of leaf material. In this video, we will take a closer look at 4 of the 5 species from North America: the Holarctic Megachile centuncularis, the abundant Megachile montevaga, the small Megachile relativa, and the stout Megachile inermis. These bees are active throughout most of the summer and visit a wide variety of flowers to provision their nests. They also utilize the leaves of several different types of trees and shrubs to construct their nest cells, giving them their common name of leafcutter bees. Species in the subgenus Megachile trace their origins back to 1758 Uppsala, Sweden. There, Linnaeus printed his 10th edition of Systema Naturae. Among his 29 described bees was one he named Apis centuncularis. Megachile centuncularis is a medium-sized black bee with rusty orange hair on the underside of its abdomen. This is the bee's pollen scopa. These hairs allow the bee to carry pollen to their nests. As for size, centuncularis is average for the genus. Both sexes are smaller than worker honeybees. Females are 10 to 11 millimeters, males average about 8 to 9 millimeters. 44 years after Linnaeus, Pierre Lettre published his Natural History of Ants and a collection of memoirs and observations on bees, spiders, reapers, and other insects. In this work, he created several new bee genera. One of them was Megachile, a name that refers to their large cutting mandibles. 76 years later, in 1878, Ezra Cresson described another Megachile from 20 specimens collected in Colorado. Cresson named his new Megachile Montevaga to celebrate their mountainous origin. Montevaga has the same general appearance as centuncularis, and it is found throughout the United States, not exclusively in alpine environments. The males have a furry appearance but lack the pollen scopa of the females. Males don't collect pollen, nor do they assist in nest construction. As for length goes, Montevaga is average for the genus. Females range from 11 to 13 millimeters, and males about 8 to 10 millimeters. In the same publication, Cresson described another Megachile collected from several states. He named this Megachile relativa. Megachile relativa is a small black bee that closely resembles the other two species we have seen. It has been used in agricultural settings where pollination is required. Populations are augmented by providing artificial nesting cavities. Males are small and fuzzy. Like other Megachile males, they have a small, stubby abdomen. Relativa is on the small side for the genus. Females range from 9 to 12 millimeters, and the males about 8 to 10 millimeters. 10 years after Cresson, in 1888, Cap Rouge, Quebec, Father Léon Provencher published his Entomological Fauna of Canada. In it, he described a species he named Megachile inermis. Inermis is quite a bruiser. It is larger than the other species, noticeably. Its abdomen appears less triangular than the others as well. It has smaller ocelli relative to the size of the head. Males are similar to the other males, only larger. They have hair on their tergites, but no punctures. The other species have heavily punctured tergites. Inermis is on the large side for the genus. Females range from 16 to 21 millimeters, and males about 11 to 15 millimeters. Both sexes sport a furry coat and dwarf this worker honeybee. 47 years after Provencher, in 1935, Theodore Mitchell, working at the North Carolina State College in Raleigh, revised the subgenus, referred to at the time as Anthemois. His paper gave good descriptions of all five North American species and provided a simple key. Despite its age, this paper is all you need to identify your specimens. Also, the Pickering and Asher Discover Life Matrix-Based Identification Guide divides Megacylia into six North American species and is quite easy to use. This is a very valuable resource and a must if you cannot acquire Mitchell's 1935 key. Regardless which resource you use, males and females require separate keys. You will not have any difficulty telling them apart. They are not similar enough to be easily confused. Females have a pollen scopa on their abdomens. Males have only disorganized hair in this location. The hair on the clypeus of the males is another noticeable clue. Often range maps break a genus apart, but the ranges of these four species display almost complete overlap. So no matter where you've collected your specimens, you will need to find characteristics that differentiate them all. As far as length goes, Inermis is by far the largest. Females average 18 millimeters. The other three are smaller, averaging around 11. Looking at their faces, we see few differences that jump out. Females expose the cuticle on their clypeus, while the males cover theirs with an abundance of long, dense hair. For females, variation at the species level exists at the sixth tergite. Centuncularis and Relativa both have long, dark hair on this segment, but Relativa also has a considerable amount of golden, oppressed hair near the tip. The shape of the sixth tergite is also an aid in determination. In Montevaga, the sixth tergite flares out at the tip and shows a concave profile, while the tergite on Inermis is straight. For the males, Relativa has a medium turbuckle on the lower edge of their clypeus. Most specimens, however, do not reveal this feature. One must lift or remove the hairs on the clypeus to see it. Another difference in the males is the punctation of the tergites. Under its dark hairs, the cuticle on the abdomen of Inermis is smooth, while the others are more like Relativa, with abundant punctation. Inermis has another character that is easy to see. In Inermis, the distance from the lateral ocelli to the back of the head is long, longer than the distance from the same ocelli to the eye. Inermis has a long head. Montevaga, for instance, has a shorter head.
Well, that should get you started. Good luck.
As always, a special thanks go to the internet resources that make these videos possible, including the Biodiversity Heritage Library, Discover Life, and Iowa State University's Bug Guide. Look for them online.